Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Saving Washington's Army, the brilliant last stand of General John Glover at the Battle of Pell's Point, New York, October 18, 1776, by Phillip Thomas Ticker, PhD. Narrated by Tom Campbell. Introduction. In one of the great ironies and most glaring omissions of the American Revolution, one of the most important battles of America's struggle for independence has remained virtually unknown to this day, nearly 2.5 centuries later. Compared to the famous New Jersey showdowns at Trenton and Princeton during the winter 1776 to 1777 campaign, and then at Saratoga, New York, in October 1777, very few Americans, including even Revolutionary War historians, have ever heard anything about the crucial Battle of Pell's Point, New York, which raged on Friday, October 18, 1776. To ensure additional obscurity, this key battle fought just northeast of New York City has been long erroneously called the Battle of Pelham Bay and Pelham Heights, when this crucial engagement took place at neither location. Exactly how important was this long-overlooked Battle of Pell's Point, which was fought in a remote part of Westchester County, New York, just on the east side of Long Island Sound, northeast of New York City? The longtime omission of the Pell's Point Battle from the annals of Revolutionary War historiography has been extremely surprising, because no chapter of American history has been more romanticized and glorified than the American Revolution, especially the campaigns of General George Washington and American victories. Without adequate military experience or training at a military school or academy, Washington had relatively little realistic chance of achieving victory when facing the experienced professionals of the vastly superior British Army, which was fully demonstrated throughout the disastrous New York campaign of 1776. In fact, Washington and his army only survived by the narrowest of margins on numerous occasions during this fiasco of a campaign in which he attempted in vain to defend New York City, which was an absolute impossibility. Thanks to the demands of the political amateurs in the Continental Congress, General Washington's ill-fated defense of New York City during the disastrous summer of 1776 was a textbook example of ineptitude, because he made so many poor leadership judgments and decisions. Washington lost the Battle of Long Island on August 27th and then escaped with much of his army across the East River by the narrowest of margins to Manhattan Island on the night of August 29th through 30th, thanks largely to the efforts of Colonel John Glover's mariners, mostly from Marblehead, Massachusetts, who rowed thousands of Washington's troops to safety during the night. It was only a matter of time before America's most prosperous port city fell. Forced to hastily evacuate New York City, Washington suffered one of the greatest disasters of the American Revolution in the early part of mid-September 1776, when he lost New York City to the superior forces of General William Howe. Thereafter, the city served as the vital nerve center of the British military effort to subdue the wayward colonies for the war's remainder, thanks to its excellent deep-water port for British warships, which could strike anywhere along the Atlantic coast. But to be fair, Washington never had a realistic chance of successfully defending America's most important city, because it was surrounded by a maze of tidal rivers, narrow peninsulas, inlets, sounds, channels, and straits that had been carved out by the advance and retreat of glaciers millions of years before. During the New York campaign, Washington faced nothing less than the most powerful navy in the world, when America had no navy in the area to counter the dominance. The struggle for possession of New York City, America's second largest city after the capital, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, was of unparalleled strategic importance from the war's beginning. Washington lusted to capture the city for most of the war, including even at the beginning of the Yorktown campaign during the spring of 1781. Washington was only reluctantly convinced by sound advice from French leaders to embark on the long march south with the French army to Yorktown, where American independence was won in October 1781. Washington's longtime obsession of capturing New York City had nearly wrecked the opportunity to capture Lord Cornwallis and his entire army on the Virginia Peninsula. well into 1781, Washington had erroneously considered that the capture of New York City was the key to winning the war instead of operations in his home state of Virginia. To be fair, Washington's strategic obsession was somewhat justified. New York City and the surrounding area were decisive ground from the American Revolution's beginning to the end. As noted, Washington lost New York City during the summer of 1776 to a mighty British invading force of 427 sailing ships with more than 30,000 troops, the largest armada ever dispatched by England. Washington met the best-trained professional military in the world with only a ragtag army of around 20,000 ill-equipped and poorly trained amateurs in rebellion, and never had a chance. Washington witnessed a whole series of fiascos largely of his own making around New York City, which were inevitable because of his lack of experience and his opponent's vast superiority on land and water. At Manhattan Island, and then later in Westchester County, just northeast of New York City, the fate of Washington's army and America's idealistic vision of a new Israel hung precariously in the balance during the early fall of 1776. Washington faced one crisis after another until a large portion of his army belatedly escaped from Long Island to Manhattan Island, which was a death trap, and then withdrew north to the relative safety of Harlem Heights, New York. Great Britain's most powerful expeditionary force in its lengthy history of invading foreign lands, especially nearby Ireland, missed still another golden opportunity to not only destroy Washington's fledgling army, but also to end the revolution in one stroke because of what Colonel John Glover and his undersized Massachusetts Brigade of four Continental regiments achieved against the odds of more than 7-1 on October 18, 1776. Howe's determined effort to encircle Washington's army and destroy Massachusetts Governor John Winthrop's idealistic dream of a city on a hill not long after New York City's evacuation was frustrated by Colonel Glover, age 43, during the hard-fought Battle of Pell's Point. The persistent tendency to refer to the significant October 18th clash of arms as the Battle of Pelham Bay has caused some confusion about a land battle that was certainly not a naval action. What these relatively few Massachusetts men of an undersized brigade under Colonel Glover achieved at Pell's Point, at a time when no other American troops were nearby to oppose the invasion, was extraordinary and quite unlike anything that was accomplished by comparable numbers of American fighting men during the course of the American Revolution. Part of the reason of the longtime obscurity of the Battle of Pell's Point has been the excessive focus on General Washington, who was not present at the battle and had no bearing on its course or outcome, which was actually a positive development because, unlike Colonel Glover, the commander-in-chief was not tactically gifted or innovative, especially when it was necessary until his masterstroke at Trenton, New Jersey. This long-neglected battle in Westchester County was neither orchestrated nor planned by Washington, because it was solely left to Glover to do whatever he could to thwart the massive invasion of Howe's army. Glover created one of the war's great tactical masterpieces and bought precious time for the safe withdrawal of Washington's army north to White Plains, New York. However, the final result of the October 18th battle, in which the British retained the field and therefore claimed victory, was a foregone conclusion from the beginning, because Glover commanded fewer than 800 men against more than 6,000 British and Hessian troops. The no-win situation of extreme importance made Glover's tactical contribution in delaying Howe's army for most of the day even more impressive. Washington and the Continental Army were repeatedly saved by the contributions of the hard-fighting field-grade officers of the Continental Army, especially colonels of regiments and brigades. For instance, only days before the Battle of Pell's Point, Colonel Edward Hand and a handful of his Pennsylvania riflemen had initially saved the day by thwarting Howe's amphibious landing of his army on the narrow peninsula of Throg's Neck, buying time for the arrival of timely reinforcements, including Glover's Massachusetts Brigade of four regiments. This surprising reversal forced Howe to then leapfrog only a few miles north to invade in Pell's Point to land at Washington's rear, which resulted in the October 18th battle and Glover's tactical masterpiece. No American officer was more responsible than Glover for saving the day for Washington twice in less than a 2-month period, beginning with the perilous evacuation from the trap on Long Island to the safety of Manhattan Island after the miserable defeat of August 27th on Long Island, and then the orchestration of his intricate defensive masterpiece at Pell's Point. More than any other Continental officer, Glover repeatedly compensated for the inexperienced commander-in-chief's lack of tactical ability and poor strategic insights in 1776, when the revolution might well have been lost. Quite simply, it took a good deal of skill and ability for Glover and his Massachusetts men to perform a series of miracles in 1776 to ensure the survival of Washington's army. This was especially the case on October 18th, when Glover waged a brilliant battle and delaying action to buy precious time on the New York mainland at Pell's Point to ensure that Washington's army lived to fight another day by escaping from its vulnerable defensive position at Harlem Heights and Manhattan Island to reach the New York mainland and then the safety of the high ground of White Plains. Quite simply, Glover played two key roles that saved the army and Washington in a short period of time by not only thwarting the British and Hessians at Pell's Point, but also by rescuing Washington from a lengthy list of his own tactical and strategic mistakes, especially in regard to the Long Island trap. But Colonel Glover's second vital role played for Washington in 1776 with his mostly mariners. The third one was when they ferried the main Patriot strike force across the Delaware River on a stormy night so that they eventually would be in position to unleash a surprise attack that vanished an entire Hessian brigade of 3 regiments at Trenton on the snowy morning of December 26, 1776, was the most important one, the masterful delaying action of a brilliant defense in depth that thwarted Howe's invasion inland at an obscure place in Westchester County, New York, called Pell's Point. While Glover's vital role in the Delaware River crossing to set the stage for Washington's first surprising victory at Trenton that turned the tide of the Revolution has become world famous, Glover's brilliant performance at Pell's Point, which saved the day, like the escape from Long Island, during one of the struggle's darkest hours, has been long overlooked. However, Washington's masterful performance in reaping victory at Trenton, where fewer antagonists were engaged than at Pell's Point, cast a giant shadow over what Glover and his Massachusetts men had accomplished at Pell's Point barely 2 months before. Indeed, what has been most forgotten has been the fact that there would have been no miracle victory at Trenton to reverse the Revolution's course without Glover's earlier success at Pell's Point. On October 18th, only a relatively few young men and boys, around 750 Continental soldiers, of a single undersized Massachusetts infantry brigade, saved the day for Washington's army and the Revolution. The defiant defensive stand ensured that General Howe's army would not march a short distance into Westchester County's interior on the New York mainland to strike Washington's withdrawing army, which was strewn out for miles and extremely vulnerable just to the west, and gain the Continental Army's rear to inflict a mortal blow to end the Revolution in one stroke. The undeveloped site of this key engagement just northwest of the Pell's Point Peninsula, located in today's Pelham Bay Park in the Bronx, has never been designated as a battlefield park. The long-overlooked battlefield where Americans, Hessians, and Redcoats fought and died when America's life was at stake, the same spot where religious contrarian Anne Hutchinson had fled the autocratic dictates of a Massachusetts theocracy in search of religious freedom and died at the hands of Native American warriors, is now covered mostly by modern development and a sprawling golf course. The ground where much blood was shed on October 18th even lacks solitude, because of the roar of the nearby noise from a never-ending stream of traffic of cars and trucks pouring along busy Interstate 95. From the beginning, the fascinating story of the American Revolution has been dominated by romantic myths and misconceptions, resulting in a gross distortion of the historical record. For nearly 250 years, far less important American revolutionary engagements than Pell's Point have been glorified and embellished, while the Battle of Pell's Point has been consistently ignored by generations of American and English historians, almost as if it never happened. This has been an unfortunate development because the men and boys who fought and died in this forgotten engagement should be fully recognized and appreciated for what they accomplished against the odds to save Washington's army on a crucial mid-October day so long ago. The supreme crisis unfolded when General William Howe's invasion force flooded into Westchester County in an effort to destroy General Washington's army, which was in a disorganized retreat only around a half dozen miles to the west. But fewer than 800 Americans, including beardless teenagers from across Massachusetts, stood firm against the onslaught from the morning to sundown on a beautiful autumn day in Westchester County. Against the odds, and severely bleeding the enemy to buy precious time, they thwarted the strategic designs of a powerful opponent who was determined to destroy America. The dramatic success of Colonel Glover and his relative handful of Massachusetts men in delaying the first British invasion on America's mainland has been long minimized by historians, mainly because of the lack of primary documentation on both sides about this all-important battle. Despite the outpouring of publications during the American Revolution's bicentennial and the longtime primary focus by historians on Washington's campaigns in the Middle Colonies and then at Yorktown, Virginia, the importance of Glover's success, not in winning the field but in buying precious time by thwarting the invasion, at Pell's Point has continued to be overlooked to this day to an extraordinary degree. Unfortunately, this rather remarkable development has occurred despite the fact that this key engagement, when so much was at stake, was not only the first battle on the American mainland during the 1776 campaign, but also the first stand-up fight between Washington's Continentals and mostly Hessian troops from Germany in a dramatic confrontation of extreme importance. To his credit, the first modern professional historian to place the importance of the Battle of Pell's Point in a proper historical perspective was George Athan Bilius in 1960. That year saw the release of Bilius's work, General John Glover and His Marblehead Mariners. Bilius explained what has been fully supported by the facts and realities about this remarkable battle, when so much was at stake for not only Washington's army, but also for America. Judged by the criteria normally employed by historians to evaluate the importance of a military engagement, be it strategic results, number of combatants involved, or casualties suffered, Pelham Bay deserves to be ranked among the more decisive battles of the Revolutionary War. The true significance of the battle lies in the fact that it saved the American army from encirclement and complete destruction. In his 2002 book, The Battle for New York, Barnett Schechter described how the tremendous strategic significance of the battle is beyond dispute. By obstructing the British advance for a day, Glover and his men helped Washington win the race to White Plains and safety. However, Schechter's insightful analysis and appreciation of what happened at the Battle of Pell's Point is not typical or common among modern historians. For instance, historian Edward G. Lengel's fine 2005 biography, General George Washington, A Military Life, relates that, on the 18th, thousands of British and German troops spilled ashore at Pell's Point, 3 miles north of Throg's Neck. If Washington had remained at Harlem Heights, the enemy would have cut him off. Yet, when Howe noticed the Americans pulling back, he did not pursue. Instead, his troops pushed slowly inland against a weak screen of Massachusetts Continentals. Incredibly, in this example, no mention at all was made of how and why Howe's army had been slowed for the entire day of October 18th, which was, of course, the magnificent tactical performance of Colonel Glover and his men. Like so many other writers and historians, Lengel's otherwise excellent book has not only overlooked the Battle of Pell's Point, but also the strategic importance of Colonel Glover's last stand on the Army's far eastern flank, while the men of Washington's Army plotted north along the Albany Post Road during a lengthy withdrawal to White Plains. A small 1936 work by Troyer Steele Anderson revealed the truth of what really occurred on October 18th, thanks to Glover's tactical masterpiece, and why the battle was so strategically important for America. The American resistance so impressed Howe that he waited for reinforcements before making a further advance. In addition, Historian Lengel's point of view represented a classic example of one of the most persistent misconceptions and myths about the Revolutionary War, that only the inherent slowness, caution, and incompetence of General William Howe and his sympathy to the American cause were responsible for his failure to inflict a fatal blow on Washington's army. This widely accepted view, as if Colonel Glover and his men played no distinguished key role at Pell's Point on Friday, October 18th, was first developed by British leadership, who were in search of a convenient military scapegoat to explain the British Army's lack of success in America. Suspicion and criticism especially focused on the Howe brothers, General Howe and Rear Admiral Richard Howe, both during and after the conflict. Historians have only perpetuated the view that General Howe deliberately allowed decisive victory to slip out of his hands, instead of any acknowledgement of the importance of Glover's skillful delaying tactics on October 18th. Despite the supreme importance of the Battle of Pell's Point, even the fundamental facts about this key engagement have been misunderstood to this day by historians. Much of the battle's specific details, especially in tactical terms, have remained a mystery largely because of its absence from the history books to deny Colonel Glover and his Massachusetts men their just due. Even the battle's exact location has escaped legions of historians, buffs, and the experts to this day. As late as the spring of 2004, and as revealed in a New York Times article, historians conducted a professional investigative search in an attempt to determine the exact location where the battle, long shrouded in myth, was fought, and they were not successful. Strangely, even the name of this important battle that raged not far from the Long Island Sound has been confused in the history books. The dramatic clash of arms on October 18, 1776, has been called the Battle of Pelham and the Battle of Pelham Heights, even though the nearest town, the crucial bone of contention, was the village of Eastchester, New York, located just to the northwest. As mentioned, this early autumn 1776 engagement has most commonly been referred to as the Battle of Pelham Bay in the history books, in a striking misnomer. The most popular designation seemed to have indicated a naval engagement, when Washington had no navy in the region. Such confusion has immeasurably contributed to the battle's obscurity in the annals of American revolutionary historiography and in the minds of Americans. And Colonel Glover's name, which has been associated with the much better-known waterborne operations, especially the evacuation of Long Island in late August, and dramatic Delaware River crossing before Washington's descent on Trenton in late December, has also bestowed a naval connotation to the battle fought on the New York mainland instead of on Pelham Bay. Another fundamental reason to explain the battle's general obscurity for so long was because even the exact losses have been previously unknown and, therefore, unappreciated by historians, which would have demonstrated its scale. Hessian losses in the battle have been an enduring mystery and source of dispute among historians ever since the battle was fought. Because Hessian losses were reported by German officers back to the German princes who hired out their people as soldiers to King George III, and not by General Howe to his superiors in London, the exact figure of Hessian losses has never been previously ascertained with any precision or exactness. However, an abundance of evidence from rare primary source material has now revealed that Hessian casualties were exceptionally heavy at around 1,000 men, making the Battle of Pell's Point one of the war's bloodiest engagements. In the past, of course, an accurate account of the Hessian losses would have partly emphasized the battle's scale and Howe's determination to break through Glover's three defensive lines situated on ever higher ground. British troops played only a relatively minor role in the battle compared to other actions of the New York campaign, and their losses were underreported by General William Howe for political reasons. As penned to his superiors in London, Howe's estimate of British losses was so low that it appeared to be hardly more than a minor skirmish of little importance. For propaganda purposes, and not to raise additional unrest in England on the political and domestic front, including opposition in the House of Parliament, British losses were officially kept at a minimum by Howe's gross underestimation. Therefore, both Hessian losses, which were not reported by Howe, and British losses have been misunderstood for nearly 2.5 centuries. Of course, Colonel Glover and his men knew much better, and their words, including from letters, have revealed as much. As usual, the truth about this forgotten battle in Westchester County can be more accurately ascertained from primary evidence, especially letters and diaries, rather than official documentation and generals' reports dispatched back to London. Indeed, corresponding with other primary documentation and evidence, a most revealing November 6, 1776 letter came from an American soldier who told the truth of almost exclusive Hessian losses at the Battle of Pell's Point. The enemy were thought, at the lowest computation, to have lost 500 men. Some think not less than 1,000. Besides Colonel Glover's modesty, self-effacing manner, brief correspondence, and utter lack of self-promotion, and as noted, the Battle of Pell's Point also has been forgotten because General Washington was not involved directly in the battle in any way, shape, or form. Had Washington been present on the field on October 18th, then this engagement would have been acclaimed as one of his army's most impressive tactical successes of the war. Instead, ironically, more focus has been placed by historians on the disastrous American rout at Kipp's Bay on September 15, 1776, where Glover's men played still another key role in saving the day with other reinforcements by making a timely arrival. Unfortunately, in part because it was so shocking and the scene of Washington's most famous outbursts of temper, the fiasco at Kipp's Bay, like the disastrous Battle of Long Island at the end of August, has completely overshadowed the sparkling tactical success achieved by Colonel Glover at Pell's Point only a short time later. Washington failed to rally thousands of routed American troops in the face of a British naval bombardment and amphibious landing of British and Hessian troops at Kipp's Bay. A distraught Washington could only throw down his hat and cry out, "Are these the men with which I am to defend America?" What has been forgotten about this famous Washington quote was the fact that his key question was convincingly answered by the same troops who had helped to save the day at Kipp's Bay and who were destined to make their tenacious last stand in Westchester County that saved the army shortly thereafter. The long-time widespread and almost total obscurity of Glover's amazing tactical defensive success at the Battle of Pell's Point has been especially ironic because 1776 was marked by an almost unbroken series of American defeats, fiascos, and retreats until Washington's unexpected victory at Trenton on December 26th. Beginning with the debacle at the Battle of Long Island, New York, in late August 1776, and continuing until nearly the year's end, a lengthy string of American reversals and disasters, the Revolution's darkest days, completely overshadowed Glover's most timely tactical success in buying precious time for General Washington's army to withdraw north from Manhattan Island to the safety of the high ground of White Plains, after delaying the powerful British and Hessian invasion force just northwest of the Pell's Point Peninsula. Ironically, even the success of Glover and his men in orchestrating the crossing of the Delaware for Washington's bold strike on Trenton has also cast a giant shadow to obscure what the Marblehead Colonel achieved against the odds at Pell's Point. Colonel Glover's remarkable tactical success in delaying General Howe's advance and buying precious time on October 18th to ensure the survival of Washington's army came at a time when the top American leadership proved especially tactically inept, especially the inexperienced commander-in-chief, who was literally learning about the art of war on the job. General Washington's lengthy list of mistakes in attempting to defend New York City included allowing himself to be entrapped on Long Island and then foolishly attempting to defend an indefensible Manhattan Island surrounded by waterways controlled by the British Navy with too few troops, while too belatedly realizing that Manhattan Island was a fatal trap like Long Island. Unfortunately for Washington and the American cause, even his top lieutenants proved equally tactically incompetent, especially General Nathaniel Greene's ill-fated decision to defend a doomed Fort Washington situated on high ground at the northern end of Manhattan Island, after the army had already departed the island. In contrast to the litany of tactical errors committed by General Washington and his leading officers time and time again throughout the New York campaign, Glover's tactical brilliance at the Battle of Pell's Point stood out, not only in sharp contrast, but also as the most outstanding tactical success of the 1776 campaign around New York City. Colonel Glover's success in buying time for the entire day and instilling greater caution in Howe to deter him from advancing deeper inland to the west, to strike a fatal blow to the retreating rebel army, ensured Washington's withdrawal north to the safety of White Plains. This remarkable tactical success against the odds in Westchester County was one of the very few shining moments for American arms during the New York campaign. In the words of historian Richard F. Snow, "For 10 weeks, Washington's forces were whipped wherever they made a stand, but one of the few bright spots was the terrific holding action found by Colonel John Glover and his indestructible marbleheaders of the 14th Continental Regiment and three other Massachusetts regiments at Pell's Point." Glover's sparkling success on the Army's far eastern flank in frustrating General Howe's thrust inland meant that Washington's army would not be entrapped in the narrow point of Manhattan Island that lay between the Hudson River to the east and Long Island Sound to the west. The greatest mystery of the American Revolution was why the British commander, Sir William Howe, during the fall and early winter of 1776, a crucial 2-month period, failed to deliver the lethal blow to destroy Washington's ill-trained army of amateur revolutionaries. Traditional explanations have routinely emphasized the failure as due to General Howe's caution that had been founded upon the traumatic experience that has been described by one historian as Bunker Hillism. However, this explanation has become too generalized and simplistic, fostering stereotypical views that have been accepted as fact for too long, including by leading historians. What has been most often overlooked was the fact that the punishment, nearly as severe as suffered by the attacking British troops at the Battle of Bunker Hill and more men than the British lost at the Battle of Monmouth, New Jersey, inflicted upon the sizable British and Hessian invading force that poured into Westchester County on the morning of October 18, 1776, was actually the real key to Howe's lack of aggressiveness at a time when he could have won the war by aggressively pushing inland to destroy Washington's army. Colonel Glover and his men inflicted losses from behind successive stone fences that made General Howe more tentative about the prospect of marching across a rural countryside covered with stone fences after having lost hundreds of men. Hence, Howe thereafter advanced north up the coast to New Rochelle, New York, instead of pushing rapidly inland and directly toward Washington's army in the hope of delivering a lethal blow. What Sir William Howe learned the hard way at the bloody Battle of Pell's Point was that American forces could prove to be most formidable by fighting guerrilla style, especially in setting up ambushes from the cover of woods, hilltops, boulders, and the lengthy stone fences. This unique brand of irregular warfare, in which Colonel Glover added his own special touch to create tactical magic, was very different from what Howe had previously learned, including at Bunker Hill, where the Massachusetts militiamen had fought in a conventional manner from fortified high ground. Glover's masterful delaying tactics demonstrated a degree of outstanding ingenuity and resourcefulness not previously seen in this war. Glover and his tough Continentals sapped the strength and momentum of any possibility of Howe's aggressive push west into the interior and toward Washington's vulnerable army in retreat, because the Massachusetts men so severely bled the attackers hour after hour. For Howe, this daunting prospect of facing the perils of guerrilla-style warfare, not from partisans, but from well-trained Continentals like Colonel Glover's small command, was as menacing as facing regular Continentals, American soldiers, in a conventional manner on the battlefield, if not more so. Glover's tactical flexibility and ingenious delaying tactics of a defense in depth, calculated to buy time and minimize casualties that he could not afford to lose, resulted in a masterful and adroit blending of the most appropriate tactics. A unique mix of conventional tactics, such as volley firing, and asymmetrical tactics in using hidden positions behind stone fences to spring a series of successive ambushes on ever higher ground of a defense in depth that perfectly fit the exact battlefield situation based on the existing topography and the few available defensive positions. After all, a heavily fortified position like a Bunker Hill, actually Breed's Hill, could always be outflanked, while guerrilla strikes, ambushes, and stealthy maneuvers could suddenly emerge without warning from almost any belt of woods, rock fence, or hilltop before the Americans, fighting more like Native Americans than European troops, prudently retired to vanish seemingly into thin air. As demonstrated by Glover's unorthodox employment of his Continental Brigade, of a clever defense in depth and tactical success that relied upon a series of ambushes. Such irregular tactics were ideally adopted to the mainland's terrain and against a more conventional opponent to sap the will and strength of an invading force in unfamiliar territory. What Glover created on his own and on the fly was nothing less than the most brilliant tactics of the war up to this point in the conflict. In overall tactical terms, this little-known engagement in Westchester County on Friday, October 18, 1776, was comparable to the Battle of Cowpens, South Carolina, nearly 5 years later on January 17, 1781, for the degree of its tactical brilliance and innovativeness of a masterful defensive depth, the tactical father of Cowpens. General Daniel Morgan's battle plan at Cowpens has been recently hailed as the most brilliant tactical plan of the war. Colonel Glover's battle plan that worked to perfection at Pell's Point can be compared most favorably to the tactics that reaped an amazing success at Cowpens. Glover's tactics at Pell's Point were fundamentally an innovative and masterful defense in depth of his regiments in echelon on ever higher ground. But without any counterattack like at Cowpens, that destroyed Lieutenant Colonel Bannister Tarleton's Loyalist command. The victory at Cowpens was basically a tactical repeat of what Glover had earlier orchestrated at Pell's Point, with far fewer troops and against far greater odds in a much more important situation. General Morgan's tactics at Cowpens have gained widespread recognition, especially with the 1998 publication of Lawrence E. Babbitt's widely acclaimed A Devil of a Whipping, The Battle of Cowpens. Babbitt's excellent book made Cowpens famous as a tactical masterpiece of the American Revolution. But in fact, Colonel Glover's tactics at Pell's Point were equally, if not more, masterful, and actually more intricate and complex than General Morgan's tactics at Cowpens. The tactically gifted Marblehead Colonel created an entire series of clever ambushes to exploit his opponent's overconfidence with a brilliant defense in depth. As noted, Glover commanded not raw militiamen, but seasoned Massachusetts Continentals, including many soldiers who once had been seamen in civilian life and militiamen who had harassed the British retreat from Lexington and Concord, Massachusetts to Boston in April 1775. When exposed on the Army's far eastern flank and entirely on his own and far from support when Washington's main army was located to the west and then retreating north to White Plains, Colonel Glover faced greater odds, possessed fewer troops, and stood much less chance for success than General Morgan at Cowpens. Had General Morgan, a raw-boned Virginia frontiersman and former commander of Washington's finest marksmen, learned about the tactical details of the Battle of Pell's Point that had been fought more than 4 years before? The distinct possibility does exist because of the close similarity of their winning tactics and because Glover and Morgan served in the same army. Glover's clever, staggered defense in depth consisted of four separate defensive lines of each of his diminutive Bay State regiments, which were established behind consecutive stone fences located on ever higher ground. In essence, a series of well-conceived ambushes. More in the case of the first three compared to the fourth, which was his strategic reverse of his own regiment, the 14th Massachusetts Continental Regiment. Most important, the Marblehead Colonel's tactical ambush in depth was cleverly set up to bleed the enemy and buy precious time by exploiting overly aggressive British tactics and leaders who had not known defeat on American soil, because General Howe was determined to gain a solid foothold by reaching the vital high ground, Pelham Heights, to ensure a successful invasion. Securing the high ground would give Howe a permanent toehold on the New York mainland after a successful amphibious landing at Pelham Bay that was unopposed. In a number of distinct ways, Colonel Glover's tactics were reminiscent of those of Hannibal, the great Carthaginian general from North Africa and the trading center of Carthage, who crossed the Alps in his audacious march all the way to the gates of Rome. Hannibal relied on brilliant tactics, including those of Alexander the Great, to achieve one sparkling success after another over the much-touted Roman legions. Among Hannibal's winning tactics was his distinctive penchant of relying on a strategic reserve to surprise the enemy after having sent troops forward, and who then prudently fell back as bait. the basic foundation of Glover's tactical plan at Pell's Point. Hannibal was especially adept at choosing the best terrain for setting clever ambushes to destroy large numbers of Roman legionnaires. And, like the British and Hessians, the arrogant fighting men of ancient Rome could not have been more overconfident, which paid immediate dividends to Hannibal, as they paid significant dividends to Glover at Pell's Point when facing an invading army that was considered invincible. Colonel Glover performed at his best in leading an independent command while bestowed with a tactical freedom that allowed him the opportunity to create one of the most brilliant battle plans of the American Revolution on his own and in short order. On October 18, 1776, and on a scale not seen before, he demonstrated extraordinary tactical ability by blending colonial tactics of the French and Indian War and the tactics of Native American warriors stemming from the hard-learned lessons of frontier warfare with the best conventional tactics of 18th-century warfare in a masterful synthesis. As mentioned, Glover's audacious defensive last stand in Westchester County bought precious time for Washington's army to withdraw north to White Plains to bypass Howe's forces, ensuring that the Continental Army would live to fight another day to keep the Revolution's pulse alive. Against the odds and all chances for success, Colonel Glover's desperate defensive effort against the odds of facing the major invasion of Howe's army under his best top lieutenants, Sir Henry Clinton and Lord Charles Cornwallis, on his own, protected the rear and extreme eastern flank of General Washington's army during its lengthy withdrawal north of around a dozen miles from Harlem Heights to White Plains and less than half a dozen west of Pell's Point. By comparison, the 1781 showdown at Cowpens was fought between relatively small task forces located a good distance away from the respective armies in the remote Piedmont hinterlands of northwest South Carolina. Most important, and despite commanding only a diminutive Massachusetts brigade of four infantry regiments bolstered by three pieces of artillery that were left with a portion of his strategic reserve positioned on the high west bank of the Hutchinson River, Colonel Glover early took the initiative to boldly march forward on his own, east of the river and without orders, to oppose thousands of crack British and Hessian troops who landed on the American mainland for the first time and in Washington's rear, when he could have chosen to retire or await reinforcements instead of fighting against the odds like other commanders would have ordered. To halt the overpowering number of invaders, Colonel Glover then pushed forward, or south, to gain favorable defensive ground to confront the invaders pushing north in overwhelming numbers. However, the general obscurity of the remarkable story of Colonel Glover and his Massachusetts troops at Pell's Point has partly been the product of the sad lack of studies about the officer corps of the Continental Army because of the lack of records, documentation, and personal information, especially letters and diaries, not only in regard to Washington's top lieutenants or generals, but also field grade officers or colonels like Glover. For this reason, Washington has almost seemed, especially from the pens of fawning historians who had endlessly glorified the father of the country, to have fought campaigns, including the New York campaign, alone in a vacuum. Indeed, since the American Revolution's conclusion, generations of traditional historians of the nationalist school have created the myth that Washington repeatedly saved and won the Revolution as if he possessed neither top lieutenants or talented field-grade officers, especially colonels. Indeed, in truth, it was the forgotten hard-fighting and tactically skilled officers like Colonel Edward Hand and Colonel Glover who actually deserved the lion's share of the credit for playing key roles in saving the day during the New York campaign. Because he ultimately prevailed in his war at Yorktown, Washington has naturally long reaped the lion's share of the credit. But in fact, it was these forgotten lower-level commanders like Glover who early often did the hard-fighting and tactical thinking on their own without Washington nearby to save the day. The general obscurity of Revolutionary War leadership in the Continental Army below the commander-in-chief has been the antithesis of the situation of Civil War historiography, in which biographies have regularly appeared year after year about everyone of a high officer's rank, especially general officers, on both sides. For instance, in regard to Revolutionary War historiography, there is nothing comparable to the detailed analysis found in Douglas Southall Freeman's classic work, Lee's Lieutenants, A Study in Command. Especially when compared to Civil War historiography, the entire Revolutionary War period has suffered from general obscurity, thanks partly to the different degrees of literacy among patriots that ensured the lack of primary source material. Therefore, many of Washington's field grade officers in the New York campaign have remained shadowy and remote figures to this day. Quite simply, Washington and his army would not have persevered without the talented officer corps that served under him, especially because the Virginian had not yet wised up to avoid matching conventional tactics with his superior opponent during the New York campaign. While General Washington primarily thought in terms of waging a conventional war like his British opponent, it was the most unorthodox, free-thinking, and tactically flexible colonels in the Continental Army who repeatedly saved Washington and his army of amateurs from self-destructing themselves and the Revolution itself because of the Commander-in-Chief's faith in strict orthodoxy and conventional tactics, almost as if he was wearing the scarlet uniform of a British officer. Washington embraced the conventional strategies and tactics that were nothing less than folly because such a strict adherence to traditional ways of waging war guaranteed defeat at the hands of experienced professionals who had been schooled at some of Europe's finest military academies. Thankfully, Glover did not think or fight conventionally, the secret of his amazing success in thwarting the ambitions of Howe and his powerful British-Hessian Army with only a relative handful of fighting men on October 18th. Washington repeatedly came perilously close to having lost the war during the New York campaign because of his blundering, miscalculations, and lack of strategic insight and tactical abilities. Indeed, barely a year after the signing of the Declaration of Independence in Philadelphia, the People's Rebellion very nearly came to an abrupt end repeatedly during the ill-fated New York campaign, an absolute disaster that would have dramatically changed the course of world history. Of course, the reality that the American Revolution repeatedly almost ended during the New York campaign has not been generally acknowledged or appreciated by historians in large part because Washington eventually won his war, thanks to extensive French land and sea power, which made decisive victory at Yorktown possible. Contrary to the seemingly endless romantic myths and nationalist narratives that have always bestowed the lion's share of the credit to Washington, the real truth of the matter was that the Commander-in-Chief would probably have been hanged for treason and the Continental Army destroyed during the New York campaign, if not for the hard-fighting abilities and tactical skills of his unknown brigade commanders, especially John Glover. This current book is the most detailed study and first modern work in nearly a century and a quarter, devoted to the dramatic clash of arms between 750 Massachusetts soldiers of the 3rd, 13th, 14th, and 26th Massachusetts Continental Regiments, and a mighty invading force of thousands of well-trained British and Hessian soldiers. Clearly, on the eve of the 250th anniversary of the Battle of Pell's Point, it is now time to explore a forgotten tactical masterpiece of the American Revolution in greater detail than ever before. Even though the October 18th engagement in picturesque Westchester County was fought within sight of New York City, the Battle of Pell's Point has been unremembered even by generations of New Yorkers who have allowed their distinguished revolutionary past to fade away. Ironically, tens of thousands of New Yorkers continue today to visit the pleasant confines of Pelham Bay Park, the largest park in the Bronx, on family gathering and picnics without ever realizing that the American nation had been saved by the hard fighting and tactics of a relative handful of Massachusetts Continentals, exactly where they have long walked and played with family members for years. Nor, of course, have they realized that the decisive day in early autumn had been saved by Colonel John Glover by employing some of the most masterful tactics seen during the course of the American Revolution. However, this unfortunate situation has been understandable, because no historic monuments or statues stand in honor of Glover and his men at Pelham Bay Park to this day. From all appearances, it is as if no battle was ever fought there on October 18, 1776, especially one of extreme importance in regard to America's destiny and future. Consequently, this current book has been written partly in the hope that the forgotten heroics of a small band of Continentals who battled against the odds will never be forgotten. After all, these young Massachusetts men and boys fought a tactically brilliant delaying action in Westchester County for the dream of an independent nation that would have died an early and ugly death if they had failed to hold firm against thousands of invading British and Hessian troops in nothing less than perhaps the most important defensive stand of the American Revolution. During one of the darkest periods in American history, when the future of the infant republic looked especially bleak and without hope of any kind, Colonel Glover's Massachusetts men repeatedly proved their worth when the life of their floundering nation was at stake. The remarkable story of what a relative handful of American fighting men accomplished against the odds will be told in full in this current book, thanks to the discovery of new primary research and documentation that has revealed the truth of what really happened in this remote part of Westchester County on October 18, 1776. What will be revealed for the first time was that the Battle of Pell's Point was in fact one of the bloodiest and most important battles of the American Revolution. It was also one of the most one-sided American successes of the war in terms of inflicting disproportionate losses and thwarting General Howe's mighty invasion force from striking inland to hit Washington's army, when it was most vulnerable and in extremely bad shape during a miserable retreat north from Manhattan Island. Hopefully, the memory of these hard-fighting Bay State men, the irrepressible Colonel John Glover, and the crucial engagement in which they battled with distinction will finally be appreciated by Americans in the present day and far into the future. In 1906, and 130 years after the Battle of Pell's Point, American artist Howard Pyle completed a truly masterful painting entitled The Nation Makers. Unlike previous American historical painters, whose subjects were highly romanticized versions of great leaders and battles of the American Revolution, Pyle devoted his fine artistic work to the common soldiers, who were the ones who truly made America with their personal sacrifices and their blood spilled on the battlefield. These ill-clothed, poorly equipped, and seldom paid young men and boys, including mostly lower-class immigrants, African Americans, substitutes, and even indentured servants, were the ones who fought year after year and all the way to the final victory at Yorktown in October 1781, especially in the Continentals' ranks. To magnificently capture the irrepressible fighting spirit and die-hard commitment of mostly lower-class and middle-class fighting men, who were primarily common yeomen, farmers, and men of the soil, in his excellent 1906 painting, Pyle depicted a motley and battle-worn group of Revolutionary War soldiers who gave the distinct appearance of having been the very antithesis of crack members of a professional fighting force. However, it was such common and ordinary men without sufficient weapons, uniforms, and supplies who never gave up and continued to fight against fate and the odds year after year, despite the seemingly endless failures of their upper-class leaders and bungling government in Philadelphia to eventually win their war for liberty. Artist Pyle's excellent painting has presented an extremely realistic look at the common soldiers of Washington's army that has contrasted sharply with the popular and stereotypical images of the most romanticized war in the annals of American history. These ragged, unsoldierly-looking fighting men sacrificed their all to an inordinate degree with blood, sweat, and tears from 1775 to 1783. Most of all, and quite unlike any other painting depicting a battle scene from the American Revolution, Howard Pyle brilliantly captured the feisty, never-say-die spirit of Colonel John Glover and his Massachusetts soldiers during the Battle of Pell's Point, where they faced impossible odds when thwarting the British-Hessian Army from rapidly pushing inland to strike the exposed right flank of Washington's unprepared army during its chaotic withdrawal north, which would have extinguished the life of the reeling Continental Army and America in short order. In consequence, the excellent design team at Skyhorse Publishing has thoughtfully graced the cover of this current book with not only this masterful Howard Pyle painting, but also with a fine sketch of Colonel John Glover in his prime, a perfect combination for a book devoted to the forgotten Battle of Pell's Point and Glover's tactical masterpiece. Indeed, in many ways, The pile painting seemed to have been painted for the express purpose of representing the heroism of the saviors of Washington's army twice in the New York campaign, especially during the dramatic showdown at Pell's Point on October 18, 1776, while demonstrating that Glover was Washington's most indispensable colonel and his Massachusetts soldiers were America's most versatile fighting men throughout the turning point year of 1776. In fact, the title of Pyle's painting might well have been The Fighting Spirit of John Glover and His Men at the Battle of Pell's Point. By the end of the American Revolution, and while still basking in his great victory reaped at Yorktown that ensured the independence of a new nation, General Washington's improbable success seemed inexplicable and impossible. In fact, a central mystery about America's struggle for liberty has continued to exist to this day. How was it even possible that an inexperienced and unschooled former militia officer and Virginia Tidewater planter from his beloved insular world of Mount Vernon ultimately could have possibly prevailed over the finest military establishment in the world? How had the mighty British Empire and its superior military leadership lost America? Such intriguing questions have continued to be debated by historians to this day. After all, it seemed as if nothing less than a miracle had allowed Washington, who was saddled with a long list of strategic and tactical limitations as an inexperienced commander that led to a host of strategic and tactical mistakes on a scale which astounded friend and foe alike throughout the New York campaign, to prevail in the end. The Tidewater Virginian literally had to learn about the art of war on the job, and it was an extremely painful process that led to disastrous results. In consequence, many Americans, both soldiers and civilians, including Washington himself, ultimately concluded how only a kind and smiling providence had been most, if not solely, responsible for bestowing decisive victory upon the infant republic and its amateur armies, which continued to blunder almost to the war's conclusion. However, in truth, the best explanation for how and why Washington's army was repeatedly saved during the disastrous New York campaign may be found in the timely contributions and performances of Colonel Glover and his Massachusetts men, especially at the Battle of Pell's Point. Fortunately, General Washington possessed not only an ace in the hole, but also a secret weapon that he repeatedly employed with outstanding success during the darkest days of 1776. Colonel John Glover and his Massachusetts men, mostly from the port of Marblehead. Indeed, what saved Washington and the Continental Army three times in barely less than 4 months in 1776, and twice during the New York campaign in less than 2 months, was one of Washington's best lieutenants and his elite regiment of Massachusetts mariners, who were as capable on land as on water. The timely rescue of thousands of Washington's men during a risky evacuation off the death trap of Long Island before they were destroyed or forced to surrender. The battle at Pell's Point, in which they kept Howe's army at bay and away from Washington's flank and rear to allow the Continental Army to safely retreat from the death trap of Manhattan Island to the safety of White Plains unmolested, and then ferrying the army, including a large amount of artillery, across the swirling waters of the Delaware River in Durham boats on a stormy night in late December, that bestowed Washington with the opportunity to strike his masterful blow at Trenton that saved the Revolution. Indeed, no Continental troops in Washington's army played larger and more important roles in having repeatedly saved the day for Washington's army than the Marblehead Colonel and his unorthodox, versatile Massachusetts men, who proved themselves to be Washington's most invaluable soldiers. Without the timely contributions of Colonel Glover and his crack command, the American Revolution would have ended in defeat and the United States would never have won its independence. This book has presented the dramatic story of Washington's most elite and dependable soldiers from a distinctive seafaring community in Massachusetts and their incomparable role in saving the day at Pell's Point. Throughout 1776, they repeatedly bailed out their fumbling commander-in-chief to compensate for his tactical mistakes to the point that they evolved into Washington's saviors, who repeatedly rose to the challenge. This book has continued the author's longtime focus on the remarkable stories of America's elite combat units from the French and Indian War, Ranger Raid, the legendary Robert Rogers and his most famous battle, 2021, to the Civil War, multiple volumes, to reveal how the crack troops of America have often reversed the course of human conflict to decide the fate of nations by rising to the stern challenge of the most dire battlefield situations. Colonel Glover and his Massachusetts men fit neatly into the rare and distinguished group of elite soldiers who helped to determine America's destiny and future, emerging as Washington's most reliable troops during the crucial New York campaign and for the remainder of 1776. Most of all, this groundbreaking book is unique because it is the first detailed and in-depth study of the crucial role played by a single Continental Brigade in one of the most important battles of the American Revolution. An unprecedented close look and analysis of a brilliant commander, John Glover, and his tactical masterpiece that he orchestrated with consummate skill on Friday, October 18, 1776, to save Washington's army. Phillip Thomas Ticker, PhD, Central Florida, August 20, 2021. Chapter 1. Unprecedented disasters at Long Island, New York City, and Kipps Bay. A former commander of ragtag Virginia militia during the French and Indian War, General George Washington was the commander-in-chief of the Continental Army and a man who had to learn the business of war on the job. The greatest love of the 44-year-old commander-in-chief of America's army of hopeful revolutionaries and rustics in rebellion was his sprawling Mount Vernon plantation in the Virginia Tidewater, and not the art of war. Washington's mansion sat majestically on the bluffs overlooking the wide Potomac River and the gently rolling hills of southern Maryland across the river just to the east. Inexperienced at commanding his poorly prepared army in his first major campaign to defend New York City, Washington was fated to lose the second largest city in North America in September 1776, largely because of the ill-advised decisions of the politicians of the Continental Congress, which had insisted that he defend the city at all costs. In keeping with the dictates of a truly Republican government of the people by obeying Congress, Washington deferred to the amateur judgments of the politicians, who themselves possessed even less military experience than the Virginia planter from Mount Vernon. A shaky and unproven civil-military arrangement in the Republican tradition that guaranteed disastrous results. Like the naive civilian political leaders in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, where the Declaration of Independence had been drafted barely a year before, these civilian amateurs in the military arts insisted that Washington attempt to hold the entirely indefensible New York City. Still heady from having boldly issued their earth-shaking Declaration of Independence during the summer of 1776 against the time-honored concept of monarchy and the divine right of kings, America's top politicians were convinced that the strategic city's loss would so severely damage public spirits and morale of the rustics in rebellion that the revolution would die an ugly death. However, the amateur politicians of Philadelphia, who had already become excessively meddling in military affairs, seemed to have ignored the simple fact that the revolution would succumb even more quickly if Washington's army attempted to fulfill the impractical demands of congressional novices at war. Ironically, the infant republic and army now risked dying of an overabundance of the spirit of republicanism during the defense of New York City. During a scorching hot August 1776 that gave no hint of autumn's approach to diminish the intense heat and humidity, and despite commanding too few troops when attempting to hold impossibly hopeless defensive positions around New York City as ordered by Congress, Washington busily prepared the infant American army in its first major confrontation against the powerful concentration of the British Empire's military might. Like America's politicians in the bustling city of Philadelphia, the former French and Indian War veteran felt that the upcoming struggle was one that very well might decide the fate of America. However, Washington possessed no navy at his disposal to defend a city surrounded by waterways and controlled by the Royal Navy under Vice Admiral Richard Howe, which was a liability that could not be overcome. Equally discouraging, Congress and Washington had already seriously overextended themselves by having dangerously embraced the heady strategic vision that Canada could be easily conquered to become the 14th colony of the young United States. The ill-founded American belief was prevalent that Canadians would love nothing more than to join a new confederation of Republican states and that they would not see United States soldiers as barbarian invaders of their beloved homeland, an entirely misplaced concept that defied logic and rational thought, given the history of nationalism around the world. Therefore, an entire Republican army had been early dispatched by Washington, with the blessings of Congress, north to conquer Canada. However, on the last day of 1775, Ireland-born Richard Montgomery's desperate assault on the mighty fortress of Quebec in a snowstorm ended in bloody fashion with his death and the first great defeat for American arms on British soil. However, what little was left of the depleted American army, which had failed to capture Quebec, stubbornly hung with an icy grip onto Canadian soil despite the arrival of sizable British reinforcements. Then, Washington lost additional good fighting men, whom he could ill afford to lose, when Congress dispatched additional troops north in April 1776 to bolster the ragged band of fighting men in Canada. Washington was shortly to pay a high price for his own strategic miscalculation and the Philadelphia politicians' desire to gain Canada rather than focusing more on defending New York City, when everything was at stake for the infant nation. If and when the British and their Hessian allies arrived in force by water in a mighty armada, as long feared, then the struggle for New York City might well decide America's future destiny. In Washington's words from a letter to the governor of Connecticut, Jonathan Trumbull, in a desperate plea for reinforcements at a time when the stakes could not have been higher, "You are sensible, sir, of the great importance of a strenuous exertion at this critical period, a period which may in its consequences determine the fate of America." In the end, General Washington's appeals paid dividends because two-thirds of his army consisted of New Englanders, of whom more than one-third hailed from Connecticut by the time of the New York campaign. Most important, New York City was well worth fighting and dying to hold. In early 1776, John Adams described the prosperous port city as the key to the whole continent. Therefore, it was only a matter of time before the British struck with a vengeance, but exactly where around New York City? After General William Howe had evacuated Boston in mid-March 1776, after Washington's successful siege and then sailed away to Halifax, Canada, because the New England Army had secured Dorchester Heights, which overlooked the port city on the south, the British had reorganized and made thorough preparations for a massive offense that targeted New York City in the summer of 1776. Consisting of contingents of experienced troops from England, Nova Scotia, the West Indies, Scotland, Ireland, Gibraltar, and the Carolinas, England sent forth the largest armada of British warships in English history under Rear Admiral Richard "Black Dick" Howe, who was William Howe's brother. This mighty force represented Great Britain's attempt to end the rebellion in one blow by capturing New York City and destroying Washington's army. British warships, carrying large numbers of well-trained regulars, steadily began to descend upon the New York City area under General Howe, who benefited from excellent top lieutenants in Sir Henry Clinton and Lord Charles Cornwallis. He found a perfect staging area on Staten Island, located only 7 miles south of New York City, from which to launch a strike. All in all, this immense force of eventually more than 30,000 men was the best officered, disciplined, and equipped that Great Britain could then have mustered for any service. However, the aristocratic General Howe took his time before unleashing an attack, to Washington's great relief, while building up his massive strength and making thorough preparations to end the rebellion. In the words from an August 13th letter from a young Maryland officer, Tench Tillman, who served with distinction on Washington's staff, 96 sail of vessels have arrived at the watering place, and we suppose they are the transport with foreign Hessian troops from Germany, troops. To our great amazement, they still continue inactive, which is much in our favor, for we are receiving reinforcements every day. On August 22nd, a letter published in the Pennsylvania Journal, Philadelphia, revealed how, "We have reason to expect the grand attack from our barbarian enemies." One of Washington's anxious men penned in an August letter, "The enemy have a very formidable army, and from the best intelligence, it is expected they will give us battle soon, at which time I hope God, in His infinite mercy, will be on our side, and we shall have no occasion to dread their numbers or experience. Our cause being so just, I cannot but hope for success." Religious-minded and gentlemanly Captain Nathan Hale, a dedicated Connecticut soldier who was destined for a British hangman's noose on September 22, 1776, wrote in an August 20th letter, "For about 6 or 8 days, the enemy have been expected hourly, whenever the wind and tide in the least favored, and therefore, we keep a particular lookout for them this morning. The place and manner of attack time must determine. The event we leave to heaven. Thanks to God, we have had time for completing our works and receiving reinforcements, and we hope, under God, to give a good account of the enemy whenever they choose to make the last appeal." And one of Washington's colonels penned a confident letter to another colonel on August 15th from his encampment on Long Island. "I am yet fully in the belief they will land on Long Island for one of their places, and where else I don't know, but I'm fully persuaded in more places than one. I wish you and your regiment all happiness. I know you will all play the man. The critical hour of America has come. Beat 'em once, they are gone." Having little intimate knowledge about the nuances of sea power and how decisive it could be in wartime, Washington had focused on creating a vast network of defenses to protect New York City, including Brooklyn Heights on Long Island, that guarded the water side of New York City, in the hope that the British would foolishly launch an amphibious assault as at Bunker Hill, where more than 1,000 British soldiers had become casualties on June 17, 1775, a year before the issuing of the Declaration of Independence. But General Howe had learned his lesson the hard way at Bunker Hill, where his men had been slaughtered in attacking a high ground fortified position. He would not make the same grievous mistake twice. Therefore, he would wisely rely on outflanking maneuvers to easily negate Washington's complex of defenses wherever he found them during the course of the New York campaign. With relatively little military knowledge in the art of conventional warfare, as taught at military academies across Europe, Washington never imagined how easily even the strongest fortifications on seemingly impregnable high ground could be easily outflanked by the combined operations of the Royal Navy and the Army's crack regulars, led by experienced commanders, thanks to the intricate system of waterways that surrounded the city and the fleet of British warships that could deposit large numbers of troops at any point, at will, with complete impunity. As could be expected, when Washington and other officers had only decided to defend the water side of Long Island at Brooklyn Heights, facing west, the end result was all but inevitable when Howe struck the land side, or the defenders' rear on the east, with a mighty army. America's most disastrous defeat of the war to date at the Battle of Long Island. With relative ease, after the British Navy had landed an invasion force on Long Island and marched inland behind the American defenders, who still faced the wrong way or toward the water, and after the British easily turned their unguarded left flank and gained their rear with almost effortless ease, Washington's rookie army was soundly defeated on August 27, 1776, during the largest battle of the American Revolution to date. Ironically, an engagement that should not have been fought because a defense of Brooklyn Heights on Long Island was doomed from the start because the British controlled the waterways. The disaster was greater because a tactically clueless Washington had steadily poured reinforcements into Long Island to bolster the defenses on an island that had become a trap. What was left of the battered Continental Army now stranded on Long Island and seemingly about to be destroyed by Howe's victorious troops was only saved by their timely escape west across the East River and through its strong currents, thanks largely to Colonel John Glover and his mariners of the Marblehead Regiment, or the 14th Massachusetts Continental Regiment. Glover's command was known as the Marine Regiment, which was one of the most exceptional units of the American Revolution. During the stealthy evacuation of Long Island, Glover's men used oars muffled with woolen blankets while rowing to New York City and back nearly a dozen times to Long Island during a quiet movement across the East River that caught Howe by surprise. The mostly Marblehead men were assisted by another Massachusetts regiment of seafarers under Israel Hutchinson from the nearby port of Salem. Against all expectations, these Massachusetts seafarers from two neighboring fishing communities on the Atlantic, just north of Boston, labored all the night of August 29th through 30th at the oars, ferrying nearly 10,000 of Washington's troops across the wide waterway that separated Long Island from the lower end of Manhattan Island. During nothing less than what was the remarkable Dunkirk of the American Revolution, Washington's men were then disembarked safely in New York City throughout the foggy darkness in what was nothing less than a minor miracle. Thanks to the irrepressible Colonel Glover, the amazing escape of thousands of Washington's men from Long Island was extremely narrow and the closest of calls. Washington was, much to his credit, in the last boat oared to safety by Glover's mariners, and he and his men thanked God for a miraculous deliverance. The escape from Long Island convinced the rustic revolutionaries even more that a kind of providence had saved the day and had blessed this people's struggle against an autocratic king who believed that he had been divinely appointed to rule the American people in any manner he deemed appropriate. But Washington and other Americans already had a king, God, and certainly did not need another one who issued harsh edicts from faraway London. On September 7th, 1776, and with the powerful British Army occupying Long Island, which it had won by use of Howe's clever tactics, a troubled Washington, who was learning about the importance of naval superiority, held a much-needed council of war. After much discussion, Washington and his top lieutenants reached a tactical compromise that boded ill for the future. Not having learned their lesson in attempting to defend both Long and Manhattan Islands, two traps, with defenses only on the water side and along a too widely extended front surrounded by water when the British possessed complete naval superiority, Washington and his army of amateurs now planned to attempt to preserve both New York City and most of sprawling Manhattan Island in still another example of folly stemming from badly misplaced overconfidence and the lack of strategic and tactical insights. Because of the disadvantageous geography of an extensive archipelago, with strong points widely scattered to cover too many key strategic points, this ill-advised decision called for a wider dispersal of the ever-decreasing number of American troops under arms across Manhattan Island, the recipe for yet another disaster in the making. But most of all, the ill-fated strategic decision of attempting to simultaneously defend both Manhattan Island and New York City ensured that additional fiascos already loomed ahead for Washington's ragtag army of innocents at war. Indeed, Washington and his top lieutenants, under the convoluted guidance of the bungling civilian amateurs of Congress, had committed absolute folly because, like most compromises, this one served neither purpose. It was not effective to save the city, nor yet the army, because it was a thoroughly bad decision. It strung the army out over 15 miles, with its weakest point midway between its extremities, and so invited the British to cut it in two in the middle and defeat the ends separately. But to his credit, and now knowing that even greater challenges for his ill-trained and under-equipped army lay in store in the days ahead, Washington at least made one brilliant decision in a disastrous campaign in which American errors, mistakes, and miscalculations seemed to have no end. On September 4th, 1776, he demonstrated wisdom by officially appointing a new brigade commander to lead four veteran Continental regiments, 14th, 3rd, 13th, and 26th Massachusetts, Colonel John Glover. The modest, unassuming colonel from Marblehead, Massachusetts, now took command of Major General James Clinton's brigade. Continuing to greatly benefit from the stealthy and swift mobility of the powerful Royal Navy's warships under Vice Admiral Howe that faced no opposition, British and Hessian forces soon exploited an obvious opportunity by landing on the east side of the East River, about 4 miles north of New York City, to gain a grip on the eastern edge of Lower Manhattan Island. From five British warships anchored on either side of Kipps Bay in Lower Manhattan, and facing west toward a thin line of American defensive works, a large number of flatboats prepared to carry thousands of well-trained Hessian and British troops toward the Manhattan shore. About an hour before noon on September 13th, and after having moved without opposition across the East River, 80 cannon from the five British warships lying in the limpid waters pounded the thin line of light earthworks and its New England defenders with a fury. This intense bombardment by expert British naval gunners was kept up for nearly 2 hours, sweeping the targeted area with a hail of cannonballs to set the stage for an audacious amphibious landing with the same ease as at Long Island, which had resulted in a one-sided British-Hessian victory from which the reeling Continental Army had yet to recover. Then at last, and as feared by the nervous New England militiamen, the terrible and incessant roar from the British cannon on the warships suddenly ceased around 1 p.m., and a strange calm descended over the west side of the wide East River, a most ominous portent. And right on cue, a vast armada of flat-bottomed troop transports, manned by British sailors at the oars working vigorously through the waters of Kipps Bay, carried large numbers of General Howe's men toward the Manhattan shore. As General Howe and other British leaders had hoped, what awaited thousands of British and Hessian troops, after a softening up of the defensive works with the naval bombardment, was not a tenacious Bunker Hill-like defensive stand of New England's famous fighting farmers, as fondly envisioned by Washington. While the Britons and Germans in bright uniforms drew ever closer to the landing site of the sandy beach, the lengthy line of American earthworks remained strangely quiet. With no volleys pouring forth from the defenses or cannon erupting like thunder as expected, Howe's puzzled men splashed ashore unopposed. They were shortly basking in one of the easiest victories of the American Revolution without the loss of a single soldier. After all, what Howe's men now saw before them was almost unbelievable. Thousands of American soldiers fleeing for their lives across the open fields instead of fighting in defense of their own home soil, as ordered. The humble son of a Massachusetts preacher and concerned about maintaining religious observance on this day of rest, on the Holy Sabbath, like a good son and obedient Christian, young Private Joseph Plum Martin described one of the great fiascos of the American Revolution that once again proved an amateur army's ineptness that seemingly could do nothing right. He wrote about the absolute disaster for American arms. It was on a Sabbath morning, the day in which the British were always employed about their deviltry, if possible. We kept the lines till they were almost leveled upon us, when our officers, seeing we could make no resistance and no orders coming from any superior officer, and that we must soon be entirely exposed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.